Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bahut shukriya Abid Ali sahab taaruf ka. Bahut shukriya Arif Kareem sahab is daawat ka aur is izzat bakhshne ka. Moses mere saathi yahan Rutulain Bakhtiari jinke saath humne Balda colony ko shinakht kiya jab aap paida nahi hue the 1980s mein, early 80s mein. और ये भी वैसे बहुत ही अभी भी जवान है 20 साल से कम उनकी उम्र है बट इत्तेफाक से उस वक्त मेरे साथ थी सारा साहिबा सन साहब मौजिज असादजा इट्स अ प्लेजर टू बी हियर एट दिस कॉन्फ्रेंस आई वाज नॉट प्रिविलेज्ड टू बी एट द फर्स्ट कॉन्फ्रेंस बट आई एम ग्लैड दैट आई एम नाउ एबल टू मेक इट एंड इट्स ऑल्सो प्रिविलेज टू बी बैक एट IOBM and to realize afresh the great contribution made by Mr. Shah Jahan Kareem in visualizing this institution and building it brick by brick, effort by effort over two decades and to bringing to fruition the first stage of his vision. And my compliments also to Mr. Talib Kareem for sustaining that commitment to excellence and to the faculty and to all of you for participating in this conference. I believe that we have a very fine representation of individuals who are involved, engaged very deeply in school education. I would like just a show of hands just to be sure how many of you are directly involved in school education. Hey, I better put up my hand also, because I'm still a student and I'm learning. And but apart from learning, one also is responsible for mismanaging and misguiding many schools. So I'm also guilty of being associated with school education, which is so vitally important. It's that first stage where the child steps out of the clutches of his parents and tries to escape. Escape both the burden and the blessing of what parents give the child. Parents, of course, bless the child with love, with DNA, with the moment and the choice of birth and class and religion in which the child plays no role whatsoever. Like every human being, you are born without a choice. We are born as slaves. You know, Rousseau said it, but I humbly disagree with Rousseau whenever I get to meet him in heaven, hopefully, or likely hell, that he said that all men are born free, but are everywhere in chains. I believe the opposite. Human beings are born slaves. They have no choice into which family they are born, into which faith they are born, what skin color they'll have, what color of eyes, how their upbringing will be shaped in the first few years. And it is only later in life as you grow that you start to make choices and you decide what kind of a person you're going to be. And it's not always up to you to decide what person you're going to be because there are influences on your life over which again you have no control. Apart from parents, what class you are born into? May I have the attention of those who are not looking at me? Because unless I see your pretty eyes, I know that I'm not communicating. And put away that little devil which you brought along, that little devil, the angel. I've only kept it here just in case my girlfriend calls me. At least I'll know that she is called. I've put it on silent. It's so difficult to make your girlfriend silent, as you know. But if she's your wife also, then she's used to this terrible man she's married to. But do children have a choice? I wish they did. Children don't have choices. And that is why we need to look at this process of education in a fundamentally different way. They have no choice. They have been born somewhere and then they are placed in a certain school according to the economic class to which that child's family belongs or the location. I'm privileged as part of my voluntary work. We work across the country in all four provinces, whether it is the remote villages of Tharparkar, or in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, or in Balochistan, from where I came back 2 days ago and barely missed that suicide bomber by 25 minutes. Whether it is Balochistan or Punjab, I travel fairly frequently, and I see the conditions in which children are earning their first few years of education. We run a school also in Zaman Town, in Korangi, where I'm always struck by the irony that here one is passionately committed to enabling children to learn for the first few years in their mother tongue. But we are living in an incredibly cosmopolitan city. On a single street in Zaman Town, you have about 6 different mother tongues. In a class of 25 little toddlers, there's Saraiki, there's Punjabi, there's Pashto, there's Balochi. And Urdu, as you know, is the mother tongue of less than 10% of the population. It is our lingua franca, but it is not the mother tongue of 90% of the people. So, how do you begin inducting the child into this process of education that we have constructed, partly inherited, not just from the British, but from our own madrasa tradition? How do we adjust to the reality that the child knows exists outside the classroom? And that reality is strong, it's overwhelming, it's so powerful. He sees it on the street. He hears his parents talking about that reality, or she hears it every day. And she sees that other twin monster television every day, I suppose, and listens to the gloom and the doom most of the time. Does the child shut off that reality the moment the child steps into the classroom? Is the personality of the teacher so magical and magnetic that it acts like sealing off reality and casting a spell on the child and saying, forget the reality, forget the ugliness, and just relate to what I am saying to you? My God, a formidable task. How can you expect one human being, a teacher, to be simultaneously connecting to 20 different individuals? And the child is an individual. Oh, I'm discovering, just become a grandfather 3 years ago. My God, what a brat he is. Mashallah, past the age of 3, he is forming such coherent questions and sentences. So even before he starts going to normal school, he is an individual. And how do we then take up experiential learning with children who are, first of all, in a most imbalanced, unequal, unjust society? How unjust? How privileged those people are who are students of the Institute of Business Management and CBM, IoBM. My God, the vast majority never get to sit in badly air-conditioned auditoriums like I am, for example, because I'm also trying to control my rate of perspiration. It's terrible. Mr. Kareem Saab, I hope the this is speakers are allowed to make complaints. Achha, thank you. I will be invited again next year, I hope. Thank you. No, maybe I'm also sweating because I'm very nervous in front of these educators, because these characters are all busy molding children's minds and shaping the future of Pakistan. But as was well said by Dr. Bari Khan earlier, that learning begins with the moment child is born. But with respect, actually, it is even pre-birth, as we know. In that womb, the baby is absorbing the sounds of the mother, the persons around the mother. It's so inbuilt, this process of learning all the time, absorbing information, soaking it up like an endless sponge. So the schools must not be arrogant enough to assume that learning begins when the child steps into the classroom. It is part of learning, part of. And the teacher has no control over those parts that are so many outside the classroom. So the best that one can do, I suppose, is to minimize the baggage of unspoken, inherited conflict and neurosis that the child is building up in the home or in the street, and try and manage coherence and stability in those tender young minds and prepare them to face the reality of life. What a formidable and solemn and noble task you are engaged in. I can never forget the teachers I was privileged to learn from. They have left an imprint which survives to this day, decades after they have passed away and decades after I'm still around. So the impact that a teacher makes, and the reason I'm concentrating on the teacher and the classroom, not on experiential learning, is that in my humble opinion, conventional forms of learning remain as important and in as critical a need for reform as perhaps the innovative part of experiential learning, which does not receive the attention which it deserves from our policymakers, both at the federal and the provincial level, but more so at the provincial level. Because this mixed blessing of the 18th Amendment, which has completely devolved education to the provincial governments, has also been a very, very ill-considered form of devolution. We are not visualizing a Pakistan built of four Khuda na khasta independent states at any point, even though there are people who want Pakistan to break up. We want Pakistan to remain a single state with four, of course, strong provinces. If not more, there should be more provinces. But the way the federal government has completely surrendered and it has abdicated its role has resulted in the lack of a singular national coherent vision just at the time when the child is being assaulted with all kinds of schisms and divisions. The divisions have regrettably grown in some respects, even though simultaneously we are evolving into a coherent, hopefully, nation, because we were not born an ethnic nation like the Chinese or the Turks or the Iranians. We are an overnight nation state. And it will take us hundreds of years to become ethnically singular as one nation. I've taken one of the first steps. I was born in Madras and my father was from Hyderabad, Deccan. And I came here expecting all my brethren here to have already conquered Kashmir. When I discovered that they had not conquered Kashmir, I decided to marry a Kashmiri Punjabi. So I've conquered Kashmir, or I think she's conquered me. But the point is that our children are the first steps towards evolving a Pakistani ethnic identity. So how do you see the present phase where on the one hand we are moving, even if we are disparate and diverse people, we have evolved a sense of being Pakistani and proud of being Pakistani. And at the same time, we see a simultaneous growth of divisiveness, of sectarianism, of hate speech, of one Muslim sect calling another Muslim kafir. The other day in Quetta, I was horrified to learn from someone who said, my son has come and asked me, and his son is 12 years old. And he said, some of my classmates said, why do you go and sit with those two boys in the break time? So the son was telling the father, I said, because they're my friend. He said, no. The other said, you shouldn't be doing that. He said, why not? He said, They are Shias. Now at that age in a school, this poison, this virus, which children have carried in from their homes, is spreading like an epidemic, a plague. And in this, how do we contextualize experiential learning? Because at a school level, first of all, most schools in our country see children jammed into classrooms which are badly lit. You go into these remote areas, even not so remote areas, there's not enough electricity to illuminate even a small class. Like kabutar khanas, they're stuffed into there. Experiential learning requires space and mobility, choices. And within that confined space, how do you create this? I am in no way being nihilistic or negative. There is potential working with limited spaces and limited means to transform that experience into almost experiential magic. And the pivot for that is the teacher, or the person who trains the teacher. A teacher's personality, the magnetism of that personality, or more than that, perhaps the genuine interest that that teacher takes in the well-being of that child, in making sure the child is really connecting to her. So difficult to do, it's easy to say that. And teachers are paid so low in private schools in particular, unlike government schools. The paradox is that most cottage English medium schools, the teachers are paid horrendously low salaries. But then the justification is that they are there only for 4 hours or 6 hours, that they can always do something and they have 3 months of holidays or whatever. But it's a great indignity to see the lack of recognition of the value of the teacher. So, let me summarize that and conclude by saying that these challenges of experiential learning, I think, need to address three levels. One, the sheer physical level. How do you make experiential learning a reality within the limitations of the physical framework in which the teacher interacts with the child? And there is scope for that. Each has to find their own way. There is no universal rule, I suppose, even though I'm sure some principles can be defined. The second would be the emotive dimension, and not to see that interaction between child and teacher as a kind of transactional relationship. कि मुझे तो तनख्वाह मिल रही है, मैं टीचर हूँ, मुझे 10 से लेकर 10-45 मिनट लगाने हैं. And then it's on to another teacher, which may not happen at the primary school level, but in general, broad terms, how to become a de facto parent without knowing what the child is going back to in terms of actually experiencing parentage. And the third is the intellectual dimension. And it's not inappropriate to say that the mental engagement between teacher and child has an intellectual connotation. You don't have to be an adult to be an intellectual. Every child has that inherent potential to use his intelligence in an interpretative way. And if that is so, how do we engage intellectually with a whole class full of children? Well, you know the answers better, but let me conclude by saying that experiential learning needs, of course, first of all, the passion to plunge into something. 1985, I had no knowledge of Tharparkar. Before that, we started organizing mobile development workshops. I had no knowledge of what would I find there. 32 years later, one is still learning about Tharparkar. So the second element is, the first is risk taking, the willingness to take risks in experiential learning and not follow conventional paths, devise your own methodology based on your context and your experience. The second is perseverance and not to be distressed by your initial setbacks or discouragements. And the third, of course, is my last point will be the truly experiential learning is learning from books, which have been derided in the previous session as being in limited or being of limited value. I respectfully disagree. I think books offer an infinite, limitless path. I've had the first yawn. Thank you for yawning right in my face. I'm about to conclude in 2 minutes. And I knew my time was up, but the yawn very nicely reminded me. And I want to stress the books dimension for 2 reasons. One, that I write books. My 16th book has just come out, a third edition. People have been foolish enough in Pakistan to actually buy the first 2 editions. So the publisher says, ki yaar, third edition bhi chhaya kar dete hain. And I believe it is selling reasonably well. So people are buying books. Visit the Karachi airport, ask the bookshop, first bookshop. I asked him, what is your sales per day? He said 15 to 20,000 rupees. Now that's one bookshop. There are 3 bookshops inside when you go into the departure lounge. Now that means about 50 to 60,000 rupees at one location people are willing to spend on books. Books. On another completely unrelated level, my publisher told me that he has just recently given a check to one of his authors who writes textbooks for medical students. Now that's a very specialized subject. But guess what? The royalty check that he gave his author for 1 year was for 46 lakh rupees. 46 lakhs. The man has earned in 1 year of sale. Chalo, keh do ke baba, that's textbooks. But let's go across to the United States, which is supposed to be the world's most intensive social media country. The largest number of television channels. Attention deficit disorder en masse. Huh? People have very short time spans. Everyone is flicking channels. I was in America 3 months ago, and the American Publishers Association announces that the sales of paper printed books in America for the past 2 years have increased to such an extent that the sale of Kindle books, electronically transmitted books, has declined. So, wonder of wonders, in a country which I thought, or we thought, had given up on paper printed books, people are returning to reading books. And another wonder, they said that the sale of children's printed books has been increasing steadily at a time when social media have spread. So let's do away with this myth and this fallacy that no one reads books. It's up to the teacher to ensure that the child remains mystified and intrigued by the magic of books. Because books is not just about telling you where to put a bandage or where to put a brick. Books are about thinking, about feeling, about sentiments, about the imagination, literature, poetry, which you won't find in manuals. Only books which are the essence of reflection, research, thought, dreams, fears, literature. So, thank you very much for your patience. I hope I've confused you as much as I have confused myself. Thank you. And I'll only leave because of my unavoidable...